With another heater strong.
Oh, yeah.
That's fine. Sure.
We doing lights off?
Again, ladies and gentlemen, today is our Capstone project. The following individuals contributed to this project: Shane Canzior, Pete Valentino, and myself, Michael Lee. As you can see, our logo design is eye candy with the eye. Desired application is analog movement followed visual light array created with digital integrated circuits. We use a lot of chip registers and also their Arduino. Implementation of basic programming. We used Arduino, which is based on IDE, C programming, and microcontroller, the Arduino. The vision, one model skull. This is it right here. 59 LEDs around it. And Arduino Mega is 2560, the model of the microcontroller, and two server motors. And
emphasis on the last one.
Yeah. I saw a lot of patience involved.
So here's some of the software, of course. Everybody's kind of had the Arduino explained to them. I think that was kind of a hit for all of us after last quarter once it was introduced. For me, it was great because it was PC and Mac compatible. I have a Mac at the house, so I was able to incorporate from both. You know, we could work on it here and work on it at home as well. And the tutorials helped. For the schematics, we used Fritzing. I was made aware of that by somebody else, but it was great because all the components that we used, the shift registers, the exact model numbers, were in the library. So when you see the schematics, it's actually what we used. You didn't have to just open up a text box and type in what you had. So there's a small list of the hardware, not really much. Eight-bit shift registers, we're using seven of them. Of course, super bright LEDs. And then your resistors just to regulate the current. We picked up the servo motors at a hobby shop right around the corner, and they're Futaba S3004s. And of course, I mentioned the resistors and the Arduino as well. You can also see purchased hookup wires here, which came in handy because they were female to male. So you can use, just get the LED, insert that, the jumper, and then interconnect, and then once you can kind of get an idea of how much we had to use. So that came in handy. And also the steering linkage, that's RC steering linkage, that helped as well with both the servo motors and the movement. There's probably half of the circuit. This is actually the skull, and or the top of the skull, and the eyes and the nose. As you see, we have three shift registers cascaded together for the blues, and then also you have the red, green, and blue LEDs, which basically you can just send pulses. They're actually four pin, one ground and then one pin for red, green, and blue. So you pulse whatever light you want or whatever combination of lights you want to have shown. That was for the ears and the jaw. For the ears, both of those ears are cascaded together, so they kind of work with each other as far as the jaw. So that's two shift registers for each. And it was, like I said about this software, it was handy that they had the Arduino Mega 2560, which made all the connections pretty simple. And then here's just the simple connections for the two servo motors that we used. So probably the highest hurdle we had to clear, biggest obstacle, was the production. For the most part, this was basically just getting two jumper wires, which were 1 foot long. So you've got two per anode and per cathode. I would tape those up and then lay the LEDs out, as you can see, and then run the program. Pretty much keeping them in order, and then also having to keep them in order when they were installed inside of the skull. Kind of like each one of them has a number, and if you get those mixed up, then when you go to run your light show, it's not going to be in order. And you can see there really wasn't that much room inside of the skull there, so all of them around the top, I was able to use my hand to insert those, and then after that I had to start using forceps and putting the LEDs on forceps and then holding them inside the skull to glue those. That's just another picture. Loose connections. I probably went through, I would say, 10 to 15. I had to throw out 10 to 15 LEDs, so luckily we purchased more than what we needed. either from loose connections or getting my hand caught in there and actually gluing my hand to the inside of the skull, trying to get my hand out and, you know, bumping into something. So, and then here's some more of the testing. Like I said, after putting in maybe 3, 4, or 5 lights, I would go ahead and run the program, and then we would be able to see if there were any, you know, any lights or bad connections or any lights that were out of order. Very, very time consuming. So it looks like everything is in there. As you can see, all the wires taped together. It looks pretty unorganized at this point. And then as you can see, we did have problems with some loose connections. We were able to get those problems taken care of as well. And there's one more shot from the other side. We like to think he is. And here's just a little shout out to Loctite. We went through 2.5 bottles. As you can see, for the majority of the LEDs, we used a mat. And I took my wife's yoga mat and cut it to little pieces. And we glued the LEDs through that mat. And then we were able to glue the mat to the inside of the skull. This would keep the whole LED from protruding out because we didn't want, you know, that much of the light. As you can see, only maybe 1/8 of an inch of the lights you can see except for the jaw. So that was a procedure with that. So after we glued an LED to the mat, you'd have to sit and wait 10, 15 minutes, let the glue set, then trim it and actually put glue around the top of the matting, place that inside of the skull, stand there and hold it for 2 minutes, and then walk away for 10 or 15 minutes and hope that the connection would hold. So overall, construction of just the LEDs took a span of about 2.5 weeks, just having that laying around at the house whenever you have time, go and put an LED in, walk away and come back. So another obstacle we had was weight and movement. I'm gonna turn it over to Pete for that. On the top.
Cool. Okay. That's cool. I feel like Dr. Mo. So basically, weight and movement. Weight and movement, this is the weight, pretty much all the weight is all these wires. We didn't know how much it weighed. I know it was like 100 something feet of wire.
A little bit more than that.
Something like that. Something amazing. The movement, basically, we had here, I don't know if you can really see it, but this is the pivot where it moves up and down. And we're just basically up and then back. What we did here is I found a aluminum shaft. Actually, try it here. I'm sorry. Aluminum shaft. I found an aluminum shaft from a Canon printer I used, and I like the aluminum because I can drill through it. I drilled through it so I can get a shaft going through it so I can connect, you know, across this way. So it would pivot. Right here is a shaft. I drilled a hole through it. I put that shaft in and I epoxied the heck out of that thing. Make sure it wasn't going to move, you know, left or right, so it wouldn't slide when it was moving. Then what happened is we had to, after all these wires were in, we had to drill a hole on this side and on that side. Very, very careful. Which we did. We were at Shane's house, put it in real carefully. It seemed to hold pretty good, so.
And the dowel as well.
The dowel, yeah, that's on the back here. You can see the screw. Yeah, the screw right here, that's for the back part. Pull it like that. But basically these, it's just sitting inside the skull. We didn't glue it or nothing, obviously, so it'll pivot.
So that first one's just a rotational access, and then the second one you pull on it with the servo that's not...
Well, the rotational one is in the front.
Okay.
You had to put it on the front because you had to have something in the back to pull it. So it has to go like that.
And that's, I mean, obviously I've seen it, but there's a spinning, that little spinning...
Right, and the whole apparatus sits on top of what rotates. Yeah.
Something we're going to get to that.
Yeah, but easy to. Oh, okay. So,
hold on, Vince, please. Let me continue. Anyway, yeah, good. Thanks, Mike. Anyway, this is that. No, okay. This actually is that steering linkage that I was was gonna say Vince, but Shane pointed out for an RC car, that's connected to a, let me go one more, please. That's connected to right here. This is the servo motor. I actually have a piece of wood that I drilled through and glued onto the shaft, the original shaft right here. Glued that on, actually screwed this on to the wood, and over here you can see it better. Attached the linkage to another dowel, which is in the back right here. So basically, we had it pivoting up the front like this, and then the back here would pull it down and back up for the servo. That's the, one of the servos. Originally, we also, too, we had a, I used a stepper motor to rotate it back and forth. Basically, the stepper motor works in a 360 degree axis. The stepper motor I found was a Mitsumi, and it had a, what they call a step degree. It was 7.5 degrees, or angle, I'm sorry, step angle degree, 7.5 for each step. So yeah, you divide the 360 by that, and it came out to be 48 steps for a full 360 turn. So that comes in handy with the programming, which we'll get to. But so basically, this is what I started out with. This was the prototype. The prototype worked great. without anything in there, you know, the stepper motor was working fine, turning, you know, left and right and going straight. And this guy was going good. He would go up and down. You can change the angles on these servos too, which is pretty cool. You can, wherever you stick that, the armature.
We have all of them.
Yeah, yeah, I mean, if you can go all crazy angles. Mike?
Good.
Anyway,
that's my favorite.
Anyway, after we had, you know, we got everything into the skull, which you saw all the wiring come out, it was basically really too heavy for the that little stepper to turn it. It would just do like this. Basically, all I was doing, we called them the Tourette's, yeah, the Tourette's syndrome. So anyway, we had to come up with another way. This was like week seven. We ran into that?
Seven or eight,
so we were really up against it. We brainstormed and figured out the spice rack sits on a rotating...
Lazy Susan,
right. So Shane ran down and bought two of them, and we screwed it onto the wood here. It's actually underneath. You can't really see where the rotating is, but it's underneath all that. We actually had to take the stepper off the bottom of the shaft, and I drilled a hole through here, and we glued the heck out of that too, and screwed it down, and it was working fine. The next step was to, hook it up. We decided to use another servo motor, because it did have a good torque, and we had to figure out a way to hook it up, and this is what we came up with. Basically, as this turns, it pulls, you know, this way or that way, left or right. Took us a few hours to figure that out in the lab and at home. So anyways, after that, we had to connect everything, because this is already put together. So we had to connect that to this, and then find out where this goes. So that took a little while, yeah, took a lot of trial and error, just turning it by hand, trying to figure out where the heck it's going to go. This is basically what we came up with right here, is what we came up with. Thanks. The programming code was the next thing. Once we finally figured out it was going to work, we had to program it. The servo side right here, we had to have two servos, so you just name them one and two. Attach it to the pins on the Arduino, which is a pulse width modulation pins, which actually, you know, sends a pulse to the servo motor and controls the movement. The other thing we had to find, actually Shane found this, is the right function. These are degrees. The servo motor works from 0 to 90 degrees. We had to find where center was after we figured out how to hook it up. He found the center, I think, was this the up or down? I don't remember which one. I this was the left or right?
I believe 35 was center for looking up or looking down.
Okay, so this was the up and down center, which is looking straight forward like it is now, was 35 degrees. And then for the up and down was 90, actually it was 90 degrees. So that was trial and error also to figure that out. After we figured that out, it's just a matter of writing, you know, zero to look left, and then I think it was 90 to look right on here, and then it was pretty much the same thing. It was 100 to look up, and then 35 back down to center. That was the motor part. Shane pretty much wrote a lot of this, so he can explain the shift registers on the LEDs a lot better.
That wasn't necessarily dreamt up by me, but I actually watched somebody on YouTube using the exact same shift register, and what he was doing in his little video was just having the binary number shown on the outputs. So that's what kind of clued me in on, I can go ahead and use this. And for the most part, this little piece of code here is, it shift out, you have three of those. So that's your shift registers, your all of your lights across here, there's three of them cascaded. So for instance, this light right here is number 1, 2, 3, 4, all the way around to 24. So pretty much had to just mark and remember which one was the first shift register and the last. And for the most part, to have those light up, like in this case, shift out LSB first, 1 is just going to turn that light on. When I want to make a change, then you have to basically, like it has in the second part there, to change that, shift out LSB first, 2, and the other two shift registers at 0 turns that light off and that light back on. And of course you have to write your latches low and then your latches high, and for each separate part of the lights, of course there's a delay time, and you change that to however you want the light show to look. So bear in mind, that was probably once we had the program for the lights, once we all figured out how to get, once we got the motors in and set and we found the code for the motors, then we just incorporated both together. So we could say, well, when it lights up or does this, at this point we can move it left, right, or have it look whichever way we want to. We just kind of integrated the two. So total, what do you think, about 54 pages of code?
Oh, when you printed it, it was
something like that.
Yeah, it came out a lot.
There is probably an easier way, if I had more time to do research, to probably get everything that we have here into that code and have it be a lot shorter. But you kind of find something that works and you go with it.
So we don't really have time to reduce it. We're not really programmers either, so.
So just like I said, keep in mind, every time a light changes, part of that code changes for every single light movement.
Vince, I have a question.
Was there a library that you have to tap into for any of that? Like, I noticed you have the servo library, obviously.
Right, no, actually that's
all just hard, right?
Yes.
Cool, man.
Yes. So it was time consuming, but I mean, this was early on, and I probably started looking at shift registers last quarter, maybe week 8 or week 9, but didn't look at the Arduino until right before this quarter started. But at that point, I was excited to see something work, and it didn't matter to me whether it was going to take, you know, a week or 2 weeks. I was just happy to have something. You know, it was progress, and that's what we were looking for that early on. So. And of course, the ultimate goal after hours of research and weeks of production and 4 months of dedication and of course teamwork is success.
Yeah.
Any questions? Anybody?
Don't know,
yeah. One thing to say is, but the way it came up to be like a coffin is, when we got done making the box, look like a coffin, so yeah, let's get a headstone and run with it. So anyway,
can we have the lights on just real quick for a second, please?
I hope you guys enjoy it. The eye candy.
Eye candy.
Okay, when you're ready.
It's just gonna blind you for a little bit, but it'll be all right.
It's about 3.5 minutes.
Yeah.
I could probably do this to the Thriller music.
Match it a little bit.
He's like, dialogue.
That was cool. I forget.
Somebody would catch
them. You wouldn't dip with that.
Me, I'm about to try.
Oh,
nice.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
The fireworks show.
Yeah.
Why do you think now? I see you.
Hey.
About some music, Shane.
You know, it's going to be just front yard next.
Somebody would probably kick it.
Right.
You put your socks up on the table. You know how much time I'm going to
get? It gave me enough candy.
They put it in the window so they can't take it.
Yeah. Frederick, I'll give you a disco show.
And that's the end of the program.
Brilliant.